Happy Friday, everyone, and welcome to Magic TV. We're recording a little bit later, and it's all disjunct, but we got there. I have a very special guest, Talia Vest. Talia, how are you doing?
Hello. Thank you so much for having me. I'm doing awesome. Happy to be here, and happy to have Magic TV back.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, we're lucky to have you. Look at the first thing I thought, you know, because we jumped on a Skype call before we started recording. Look at Talia's background. Look at everything. I'm like an institution. I've got like white walls behind me. It's all like nothing. And you have this gorgeous setup behind you.
You know, I wish you could see more. I have like Jace over here and some magic artwork and some magic cards and some decks. I wish you could see more, but it's like background. And I've really struggled with like using a green screen versus just having my background. But I really like expressing myself through my background here. I got some EDH decks sitting on my table because I do stream a lot of EDH as well. So yeah, we just have a casual Birds of Paradise laying here.
I was going to say that. I love the fact that in the background, there's just a deck, like an EDH deck. And I wasn't sure if you were building it or if it was to play or what, but it's just sitting back there.
I was working on them. I was editing them.
Nice.
I'm going to be doing a couple of streams coming up, EDH streams. So they'll be fun.
Very, very nice. So speaking of streaming, you can find Talia. She streams Monday to Friday around 2 p.m. Central, twitch.tv/TaliaVest, but it's two A's in the Talia. So TaliaVess.
That's right.
You're on social media under TaliaVest. Hey, look, if you look for TaliaVest, you will find Talia here on Insta, on Twitter, everywhere you look, she's there. So we're very lucky to have you on here.
Actually, the deck that's sitting right here is where my name came from, which is Kalia, one of my very first EDH builds.
Okay.
But, you know, my real name is Trace, so I just took the T and I put it in instead of the K and decided that I liked the name Talia. So that's where that came from.
It sounds
really cool and like exotic, so why not?
I thought it came from I'm sure a lot of people
Thalia.
Thalia
is a great card, but no, Kalia has a special place in my heart. My very first build, so that's where it came.
I like that. Yeah. So speaking of your first build, what's your Magic origin story? How'd you get into Magic?
Oh, I got into Magic through my Dungeons and Dragons group. So I was playing Dungeons and Dragons every single weekend for a few years with a group of my close friends. And one day they brought over a box, a booster box, and were like, we're going to draft this. And I was like, okay. I had played deck building games before. I play a lot of tabletop games. So I was mm-hmm. used to that. I played like Fairy Tale and Ascension and stuff like that. So I fell in love immediately. I just loved that you could be creative right there and like have to build something and find out if it works. And if it doesn't, that's okay. But you learn from your mistakes. And I just like that because it's always evolving. It's always changing. Every time you draft, it's different. So I just fell in love with that. I can't stop.
Do you remember what set it was?
So I can remember buying packs at my local game shop of, I don't remember what it was called, but they had a lot of Infect cards. Was it Mirrodin maybe?
And it had to be something like,
Avacyn Restored. Restored was already like out for a while, but I do remember being able to like walk into the store and get packs. So it was somewhere around that time frame. I wish I remembered. I'll have to go back and look at the list.
See, I get to cheat because I know what was like, it was like unlimited revives because I'm an old dog. So I get to cheat with that. I don't have to remember exactly what set it was. What's your favorite format?
Oh, my favorite format.
Limited format.
Oh God, it's so hard because I love EDH so much. But I'm
just to draft. What's your favorite block or your favorite sets to draft? I'll make it easy on you.
Oh, okay. So I really, really loved Battle Bond, which I'm actually going to have a chance to play again very soon because my local game shop actually just bought a box from you, actually, from Channel Fireball. So we're going to get together as a group and draft that.
Nice.
I really enjoyed Dominaria as well. And I remember also enjoying Conspiracy because it was kind of like centered around Draft. Do you remember Conspiracy?
I didn't draft any of Conspiracy. It was, I was working a lot of Magic Fest when that was out, and it was massively popular. And I think one of the things that Wizards, I think, may have learned with sets like Conspiracy, with the unsets, and then with Mystery Boosters, is there's a way where we can contextualize Magic the Gathering, like the drafts that we have limited, and it's still got that feel of limited, but it kind of starts to feel like almost a different kind of board game when it grows in a different way. And a lot of people love that. That's why I think that's why Mystery Boosters are so popular. I think Chaos, that's kind of why Cube is popular.
And
all of that. It's like this whole, when it engages this whole other level, I think there's a ton of popularity there. So I love it when they do that, because, and then you can see kind of like, if you go look at like Unglued, I can't remember, we did a look at this at some point. Sometimes they experiment in very clearly with Mystery Boosters, they experiment with different ideas mechanics, and then and then they become mechanics or watered down versions of them or altered versions that become mechanics later sets. So I love giving them that paintbrush and letting them explore.
I really, really loved drafting the unsets. I bought every single one in Drafted, a booster box. I remember one mechanic that I really, really liked was just getting to roll a D20. You know, being a Dungeons and Dragons player, I was like, this is so cool.
Yeah, that's true.
I love that. They don't really do that like out of the unsets, but that was pretty fun.
Okay. Okay. That's a pretty good origin story.
I like the gambling aspect in a way.
I mean, the variance aspects. We'll just say variance here, just to keep it nice and clean.
Yeah.
So we're gonna run through some sweet factor fictions that Tali and I have talked about, and then we've got a very, very special EDH centered top eight. And I'm just happy that there's an EDH top eight, because I don't play EDH. I played once, and I was in a four way battle. I can't, who was in it? It was Krim, Riley. Oh God, now I feel awful. I can't remember who the fourth person was, and I won. And I was like, that's it. I'm done. No more. I'm retiring from the world of Commander.
It's like,
I'm undefeated.
I won.
So,
what deck did you use? Do you remember?
Some random red deck Krim had. He handed me a deck. So I don't know if you know this. Like, Krim used to work for us. So and years ago, before he was the Asian Avenger, he was just Krim. And I interviewed him for a job at Channel Fireball, and very, very appropriately and correctly hired him. And he worked at the Game Center and did a bunch of stuff for us. And he was always awesome. So he's got such a special place in my heart, because he's kind of grown up in the store.
I've ran into Krim a few times around the Magic Fest circuit and at TwitchCon. We were going to play a Commander game, but it didn't work out. But I was really excited. Maybe one day.
Yeah.
I love Krim.
Yeah, I mean, you should. He's just a lot of fun to play Magic with. He's very, very, he's a very animated person.
Yeah,
so.
He is.
So I will start you off. We'll dive into some fact or fictions, but I'm gonna keep it nice and easy. We'll start real casual, and then we'll get into some serious Magic ones. Okay, are you ready?
Okay.
Fact or fiction: In-N-Out is better than Whataburger.
Oh my God, In-N-Out is 1,000% better than Whataburger. Are you a Whataburger fan?
I'm from California.
I'm born and raised in Texas, and I hate Whataburger. I hate it.
I don't hate it. I just think it's super overrated. That's absolute fact.
Low tier. There's,
yeah. No question.
I love it. I actually just got to try it for the first time last year when I was traveling through Magic Fest.
But see,
I went
to Magic Fest
Vegas, and that's the first time I tried it.
Part of the reason you're down on Whataburger, though, is you grew up with it, right? Like, I'm sure I value In-N-Out.
Awful. Like, it's just greasy and like...
The chicken's good, isn't it? I think I like the chicken. They have like fried chicken or something there that I like. I am not a Whataburger fan at all. I was prepared to be amazed. All my friends who were from Texas or lived in Texas for any amount of time were like, oh, it's so great. It's amazing, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, get real. Yeah. Now, I also know that there's an affinity for Shake Shack thereabouts.
Yeah,
so Shake Shack.
Shake Shack is like my number one.
Oh, you have Shake Shack over In-N-Out. They just opened a Shake Shack right across the street.
It's quality.
From where I live. I haven't been there
it's
yet.
It's quality meat. I mean, I'm a good meat eater. Like, the beef is just so good. I get like a triple.
I've got to be careful because I have a huge sweet tooth. and it's really hard for me to get off the concrete.
Shake Shack has some really good shakes too.
They're not even shakes,
really. They're more like concretes, like you said.
And for those who don't know, a concrete is like a more solid McFlurry. Like that, I kind of think of it like it's upside down thick, right? You turn it upside down and it sticks there. All right. What's another good fact or fiction? So, oh my gosh, I didn't even mention this. So let's talk about the Vessian stuff, because Talia was wonderful enough to send me this awesome box of stuff. And so people, you may look at that and you're thinking, wait a minute, is she wearing an MTV shirt? But it's not, and it's an MTG shirt.
You know, I'm an 80s baby. I grew up in the 90s. It's very nostalgic for me. So I just wanted to kind of have that vibe going on for my stream and my community. And so I pretty much went like all in on Memphis Design. Memphis Design is actually like what MTV Design, I guess, was originally from Memphis Design. So that's where that came from. MTV used to be great. So I basically,
back when it played music videos.
Yeah, back when like they only played music videos. But yeah, pretty much just, it looks like MTV, but it's MTG. Vessian Studios, because of my background in production, and I kind of run my own studio now here in my office. So yeah.
No, it's awesome. And you also had a custom coffee blend in there. Vessian Ascendancy?
I did. So my local game shop, Coral Sword, carries Greenway Coffee. Definitely check it out. Super, super awesome place. Amazing coffee. And they have a roaster there behind Coral Sword, the local game shop. And we worked together to make a Vessian Ascendancy special blend. Did you get to try it?
I did. I've had many of the different Greenway beans, and hand to God. So we don't have great coffee taste here in the Scanlon household. We drink a lot of Pike Place. Just grind it up and put it in there.
I like Pike's Place.
We love it. I mean, I've got a cup right here.
Nice.
But every once in a while, we get like a bag a month from Greenway. And so I think I've tried 6 different bags, and I am completely honest, hand to God here. We brewed it up and I took a sip and I said to Elaine, my wife Elaine, I said, I think this is the best blend Greenway's ever had. I'm not joking. It is my favorite Greenway blend. 100%.
I think it's very like fruity, but not, I don't know how to describe it, but it's also like smooth and kind of,
it's
chocolatey in a way.
Yeah. It tasted more, and this is way too generic a term, because it makes the other coffee.
You did get it a little late, so it maybe was a little stale too.
I would say it was almost more palatable. It was very easy drinking.
It
went down very, very nice. Like, so the thing about, like, for those of you who don't drink a lot of kind of higher end or small roast coffees, it tastes different than when you go to Starbucks, there's like that char taste to it.
Dark roasted,
right. And
the roast on these coffees are very like perfect yes. roasted, not overly roasted.
And there's like, it's like fragrant, it's nice, it's wonderful. Exactly. So yeah, check out is it still available on Greenway?
Yeah. Well, actually, I don't have the Vessian Studios available on greenway.com, but you can definitely get that same blend. It's the Ethiopian blend.
Okay. Check it out on Greenway.
Yeah. Greenwaycoffee.com.
Is there like a code you get or anything, an affiliate code?
No.
Okay. Well, it has wonderful
business.
Yeah. It's a wonderful coffee place. Seriously. I've ordered coffee from there for a while, and you can just get on a recurring thing where they'll send you a bag. What I did is you start with a bag a month, and then you can kind of go up to a bag every 2 weeks or a bag a week, and it like just keeps coming. So definitely 100% shout out to Greenway. They make wonderful, wonderful coffee. So I was going to do fact or fiction coffee or tea, but no. But fact or fiction. Yeah. Here's a good fact or fiction. Hot coffee is superior to iced coffee.
Oh my God. Okay. That's really hard, because I like both. But
same.
There is something about just having a warm cup of coffee when you first wake up. You know, it just is so soothing. I'll have to go with hot on this.
Yep. Fact. I think it is a fact. Hot coffee is superior to iced coffee. I like iced coffee. Of course, half Japanese. In Japan, we drink iced coffee by the bucket loads, but it's all like creamy and sweet, which when I was a kid I loved, but I don't, I 99%
that's how I, yeah, if I get an iced coffee I definitely get some like sweetness in there.
It's nice. Yeah. And then
it's like a nice refreshing kind of in the middle of the day. I'm in Houston, it's hot all the time, so I'll do that like more in the afternoon.
It's the game changer for me has been like the nitro coffees. I really like those. I really like the kind of like the smooth.
You do?
They get me really wired though, so I can only have have very little.
Yeah. But, yeah, they seem to have a higher caffeine concentrate.
Yeah, somehow it hits you. But hot coffee,
they hit different.
Yeah, but hot coffee all the way. It's way, way better for me. Okay, final fact of fiction, because I know in Houston, from different Instagrams I follow, their donuts are huge. So, fact or fiction, donuts are a breakfast food only.
Definitely fiction. Definitely fiction. I have a donut right here. Actually, it's downstairs. I just picked up an afternoon donut because they just throw them away at the end of the day. They just dump them in the dumpster. So I always go in the afternoon. I get a free donut. So,
well, okay, free donuts are the best donuts. I do want to say though, because these donuts are beautiful.
It's like cake.
Yeah, it is.
At any time.
But they're gorgeous. Like the presentation on these donuts at all these places on Instagram, they're unbelievable. And I should have gone the other way. Maybe it's fact or fiction. Donuts are not a breakfast food.
Donuts are not a breakfast food. Fact.
Yeah, I think so too. I think we've gotten there, right? High-end donuts.
Did I mess that up?
No, that is a fact. I think I switched it. I asked it wrong, but because high-end donuts, you don't want that in the morning with a cup of coffee. Like maybe an old-fashioned. Maybe
I really don't want. Yeah, unless it's just like a plain donut with your coffee, like plain cake or something. Mm-hmm. I just really don't want all that sugar, like first thing.
I'm with you completely. Yeah. Okay. That was our warm-up round. Now let's get into some magic talk. Are you ready, Talia?
Those are some good fact or fiction questions, by the way. Those like all hit very, very home for me.
I had to push it around a bit. Push it around a bit. So there we go.
Yes, I am ready for the magic series.
Okay, fact or fiction, Cube is the greatest limited format.
Oh, my God. Okay. I love Cube. I love Cube. I'm gonna have to go fiction on this. Just because.
What?
When like a new set comes out, there is this just unexplainable feeling of drafting a new set for the first time and figuring it out. And it's just always different. With the Cube, I love Cube. I've built several, but it gets repetitive because you know exactly what's in there. You know the archetypes that you're looking for. Whereas with the new set, it's just always fresh.
What about Moto Cube? Because they change it. They like refresh it all the time.
They do. Yeah, that's true. Because I think they have Innistrad right now. And I really like drafting that set. So you can like revisit stuff that is older, which is really nice. I guess, oh God. Yeah, that's no, I'm going to stick with it. I'm going to stick with it.
I like it. Stick to your guns. You know, I have gone back and forth on this one. This has been a fact or fiction that we wrote out like 3 weeks ago and just haven't gotten to yet. And Gabby and I have talked about it and I don't know. Because from what you're saying, things are fresh. And when we have sets, like whether it's Zendikar Rising or even M21 or whatever, there are strategies with the keywords built into the set. And you get to take advantage of that, right? Like Roost of Drakes in a cube isn't going to be the same thing because there aren't a bajillion kicker cards and kicker strategies to play. So it becomes really, really tough. I mean,
it's hard. I love
it. It's hard. Ultimately, though, I think I'm going to go with fact. I have a cube. It's horribly out of date. It has not been updated since Shards Block. So it's very, very out of date. But yeah. I have a lot of fond memories of cubing in the old game center. And just over and over with, there were two different cubes we played a lot of at the old Superstars and then Channel Fireball Game Center. And there's a, it straddles, like good cubes straddle this bridge between like limited and constructed, because you're still drafting, you're still playing limited, true, but the power level, the cards is so high that you, yeah, you feel like you're putting a constructed deck together. Now, I'm not one of those, I don't like storming cube. I hate that kind of stuff. But
I took that out of my cube, actually, the storm. It was, yeah, too hard to pull off.
It's too all or nothing. And
it when is.
If you're playing on Moto, I guess, you know, you want ticks and stuff. But if you're playing with friends, you don't want someone getting halfway into storm and then building an awful deck. And then they're just like locked into a non-playable deck for the next, yeah, however long. Right. It's no bueno. But
you know, you could definitely change your cube. You know, new sets are coming out and you can just rotate stuff out. So I like having cubes.
Yeah. Oh,
you can just grab and play anytime. Everything's sleeped up, ready to go. That's a hard one.
I don't know. I think
I'm kind of going back on like, maybe it's a fact for me because I do love cube.
Every limited player on the planet loves cube.
Yeah.
You know, and so it's just hard. A matter. But then, go ahead.
And when you're playing a powered cube, it's just, okay. So in my powered cube, I have fake power nines, of course, but it's super fun just getting to experience that and play with like the moxes. It's yeah.
This is the perfect segue. Fact or fiction, Talia?
Mm-hmm.
Do people who know you really call you Talia, or they normally call you Trace? Because in person, I started calling you Trace, and then now because of this, I'm like, say Talia, don't say Trace.
It doesn't matter.
Okay. All right, Trace. Either fact way. Or fiction? Legacy Cube is better than Vintage Cube. This is the power question.
Fiction. Wait, you said
Legacy Cube is better. So if you say fiction, Vintage is better than Legacy Cube.
Vintage is way better.
Oh, hit me. Sell me on it.
Yeah. Because I want to play with power cards. I want to play with soul rings. I want to play with moxes. I want to play with these cards that are crazy. Like sometimes you don't want to. I understand, which then I would play Legacy Cube, but I have to go Vintage on this one. Yeah.
I have to say fact, I really prefer the Legacy Cube because of how crazy OP the starts can get with Vintage Cube, where it's just I've had demoralizing starts where someone will go like jewelry or, you know, power nine into soul ring. And I'm just like, I am not going to win this game from turn zero for me. I haven't even drawn a card yet. So it drives me crazy. On the other hand, what you say is right. When you're the one who's like going like jewelry into soul ring,
Mox Ruby or whatever. And like,
it's amazing.
Pack two comes and you have a soul ring and it just all comes together. Like, it's awesome.
It's, yeah. I've got,
like, you can't play with some in Legacy. You can't play with Ancestral's Recall. I always like pack one, pick one Ancestral's Recall or like Balance or like some of the stuff is like
Balance.
So
I do
fun
love.
Yeah, to pull Balance off in like and play. I like them both, but I'm going to have to go with Vintage on this one.
Oh, I think they're both good.
They're both amazing.
As a rule, I generally prefer unpowered cubes. This also segues into, it's almost like there's a roadmap here. Fact or fiction, Soul Ring should be banned in cube.
Fiction.
All cubes. I think absolute fact. I think it's better than jewelry. So maybe, God, now that I hear myself, I'm like, dude, Mosh. You got some PTSD over some soul rings or something? Like, what happened? I have gotten destroyed by soul ring.
You? I always take soul ring. If, like,
it's got to be number one, doesn't it? I don't draft enough vintage cube, but
there's different circumstances. If I have like pack one, pick one, sulfuric vortex, I usually take that just because I love that card.
That's the best card in cube, by the way. Well played.
You like it?
Oh my, of course. I'm an aggro player. I love it.
Oh, me
love
too.
It.
I'm aggro. So if I see that, I'm like, okay, done. We're going like
mono red, all in.
Mono red, yes, but you can also splash colors with that.
I guess, yeah, because you have duels. Like, you have duels, you can easily do it.
But oh my gosh. Soul Ring is just really hard to pass up. If you see it, just take it. If you're lucky enough to get it, just take
That's why I'm saying you should be banned. It's too good. It's one mana. It comes into play untapped. You instantly get your mana back plus one. It's just insane. When you untap, when you go turn one Soul Ring and turn two, you have access to four mana. Get out of here.
Yeah, I think you have some PTSD going on.
That's very, very possible.
If you want to play without a Soul Ring, just play Legacy. There you go.
That's right. Well, that's my whole thing. I said, like, Legacy. I like the Legacy Cube. That's where I was at with it. But
yeah, I want the power. I want the power.
All right, we'll get a little bit more general here. This won't be cube. This isn't necessarily cube. We've done a bunch of cube ones. This isn't necessarily cube related, but fact or fiction, you should only draft two colors.
Fiction.
Really? Just as a rule of thumb, sets are going to be different. I get that.
I am known to be like crazy and draft three colors and pull it off. I will say, like, I stick with a solid two and then I'll splash for like a third color if I have cards that are worth it. If I don't, then I'll generally just stay with two colors because it's safer. But if I have something crazy, I will definitely go three.
I mean, if I'm playing green and I got like a rampant growth type effect,
yeah, if I'll you have, look like, at mana fixing and for sure.
That's different. That's very different. Sure. But as a general rule, I am not going more than two color.
I mean,
I've had a few like mono red decks in Zendikar Rising. It's like, oh, hey, red's open. Oh my gosh, I have all the red cards, you know? So I am very much like,
like a mono colored type of drafter, or
if it's available to you, like generally not the, like, you have to be like that's the true. Only person at the table drafting color, whatever. And even like, and in some sets, like an M21, if you were the only black player, you're still going to lose. Like that color was just awful in that set. So, but I rarely, now most people I know do get greedy like you. Most of the really good players I know will get greedy like you and then go greedy. Go for that third color splash. No, it's totally greedy. It's absolutely greedy. So, okay. One last fact or fiction before we dive into our top eight. Fact or fiction. It's a good idea to bluff lands in hand. This is for limited. It's a good idea to bluff lands in hand.
Fiction.
Really?
Yes. There's been so many times that I'll hold a land back. There's no reason to play it. And then I'll draw like, you know, my big like 8 mana card that I need to cast. And then I can't because...
Wow.
I didn't play my land. It's just hurt me way too many times. And I don't really see the point. I don't know.
I think
I'd rather just play them out. And there's like discard effects. I don't want to discard my land. I guess it depends on the matchup, but yeah. Yes.
It depends on the matchup. It depends on the colors, right? Like if you hold that land back, I'm big time fact. I bluff lands all the time. I hold lands back all the time. Sometimes like if you have like, have you drafted a lot of Zendikar Rising or no?
I have.
Okay.
I have.
So like if you're playing red, maybe you've got some Fissure Wizards or you're waiting for your like, the 3/4 landfall. Landfall is a good reason to hold stuff back. So that's just a key word thing. But that's just for Zendikar Rising. In general, though, if you're playing red or black, sometimes, or even green with giant growth effects, I'm trying to bluff the instant. I think the discard thing is real and I hate that, but what I always tell myself is, well, you know what? Fine. You got my land, but I'm glad I didn't have a spell in hand that you burned it. Now I tell myself, yeah, you used it now and you wasted it. And all you got was this land, which maybe that's not the way to look at it. But I hold lands back all the time.
You're right. Actually, with the latest sets into Zendikar Rising, I do hold my lands back a lot.
That's a key word.
But
thing,
that's
though.
Because like, yeah, because the landfall triggers and things like that.
Totally.
And sometimes if I'm playing a control deck and I'm in blue, then I'll hold lands back just to make them think I have like a counter spell.
You should.
It's very situational, I guess, but
I mean, I definitely have played games against like blue decks in Zendikar Rising, and they keep leaving four mana up, and I'm like, okay, I know you have that into the Royal, I know you got it, and then maybe they do, maybe
bluffing
they don't.
Who knows? Bluffing is very important in this game too. So, I think God, that's a hard one. I might lean a little bit more towards fact. I think it might help more in today's current meta right now.
Right now, I mean, it's kind of like in a neutral game state with all things being equal, do you hold lands back as a bluff? And in general, I do. Regardless of whether there's landfall or not, I almost always do. So I'm definitely fact there. So
okay, I have to point something out because I'm looking at, I have to admit, I haven't really played Legacy too much. I mostly just play Vintage, or like I have a Pauper cube and a Peasant cube. But my favorite card, one of my favorite cards, is actually banned in Legacy. So I'm 100% going with Vintage, and that is Tinker.
Well, so
I will always pick Tinker.
My biggest thing,
any way to like cheat out creatures, like sneak attack, things like that. Those are my favorite cards to draft. Okay.
Sneak attack is way more fair than Tinker. Sneak attack, you have to draw the card. Tinker, it just has to be in your deck somewhere. Like, that card is, you
just, I mean, like sacrifice a Signet or whatever. Here you go. Here's a Blightsteel or whatever.
You have no idea what Standard was like when Tinker was in. It's just, it was
I wasn't around.
It was crazy. It was a very, very good strategy. It was actually, it was kind of a thing, you know, known like aggro Tinker decks. And then it came out of nowhere at Worlds, and Johnny Magic himself, John Finkel and Bob Mayer, played this roguish version of Tinker, and they made it all the way to the finals and played against each other. And I think the differentiator is one was playing Brainstorm and the other was playing Stroke of Genius or something like that. But that was old dogs know these things. So, all right. Are you ready for our top eight, Talia?
Super ready.
Okay. This week's top eight is very, very interesting. So we were going back and forth, and I want to give all the credit to Trace here, because she came up, she was like, hey, it's Halloween, you know, we're coming towards the end of October, and it's Halloween, let's do something cool. And she's like, top eight vampires. And for a while we were like messing around with vampires, et cetera, and how about this, how about that. And then she, you know, you said, well, you know, I only know EDH, and the light bulb goes off. I go, we just do top eight vampires in EDH, because we don't do enough EDH on Magic TV. So this is the perfect thing. And then here's the piece de resistance. And I don't know. You know what, everyone? I think I got played. Now it's all coming together, Trace, because then all of a sudden it's like, oh, yeah, I have a vampire EDH deck. Oh, yeah, I have a vamp. So I was like, oh, this is perfect. You're the perfect toast for this. And now I realize it was all, I was maneuvered straight into it. I'm on to you. I figured it out. So,
yeah, that's one of my favorite EDH decks that I have, because it's very aggro and very fast. I like it. And that is the Edgar Markov deck, which we'll go into some more details later regarding that. But I just edited it because, that's a hard word to say. Re-edited it, and so I have kind of a fresh take on a vampire top eight for vampire EDH. So.
And when Trace says she was editing it, I'm talking like we were literally discussing cards in Slack, and she wouldn't type out a card name. She would take a picture of the card in her hand. She's like, yeah, I'm working on this deck right now. How about this card? How about this card? And I'm like, oh my God. You know, so this is all true. If you can see my Slack, it's just comment, picture of vampire card, comment, picture of vampire card. So it worked out perfectly. Any honorable mentions?
I love editing those decks. I do want to honorable mention, Olivia Voldaren, because she's a really, really, really good card. And this Voldaren, so pretty much, let me get the card pulled up.
I've got it right here. I can read it to you.
Yeah, Liv, read it to me.
Good old Liv. She's, first of all, wonderful art. She's kind of floating with the glass of blood. Card. One red, one black, two other for a legendary 3/3 vampire. She has flying, and for one red, one other, Olivia Voldaren deals one damage to another target creature. That creature becomes a vampire in addition to its other types. Put a +1/+1 counter on Olivia Voldaren. And then for two black, three, gain control of target vampire for as long as you control Olivia Voldaren. You can see this thing getting out of hand pretty quick in EDH.
Yes. So she can get very large, very fast. And I love the fact that you can just steal other people's creatures. Sometimes it doesn't work out in my deck just because there's so much removal. But I just wanted to mention because she definitely, I feel like she saw play in Standard at some point.
She did. Oh, no, she totally did.
She's a very powerful card, but I just, she didn't make my top eight. She didn't make my top eight, but super, super awesome card. And definitely still playable, still in my deck, but.
She was on the line for all those out there. Like Tracy's going back and forth, like, oh, does she make it? I'm like, look, hey, we should just honorable mention. She's like, oh, okay, we'll just do that. So yes. There we go.
There's just so many new vampires recently. So I wanted to touch on some of the new ones too.
Do you know what Sengir Vampire does?
Which one?
Sengir Vampire.
That's a really, really old one, right?
No, you can't look it up. No cheating. Do you have any idea? You cannot look it up. Do you have any idea what a Sengir Vampire does?
Sengir Vampire. I feel like it was just a flying body, like a 4/4, but I don't remember the mechanic at all.
So, good old Sengir is the original vampire. Alpha, Beta, Unlimited. Ouch. 2/3 for a 4/4 flyer. When a creature dealt damage by Sengir Vampire this turn dies, put a +1/+1 counter on Sengir Vampire.
Oh, that's OG. Gross.
The OG. You know, it was one of those cards that you thought was amazing and you loved when you opened, and turns out it's not that great in tournament play. But yeah, the OG Vampire, Sengir Vampire. So,
was that seen more in Limited play?
That was, so Limited play is really interesting when you talk about the old sets, because it didn't exist. Like, the first set that was really built with Limited mine was Mirage. So we got all the way through Legends, The Dark, Fallen Empires, Homelands, Ice Age. People drafted those sets, but they weren't really for draft. And then Mirage Block came, and Mirage Block was really designed for draft. So Sengir Vampire was insane in Limited. And it, you know, has since been reprinted many times in formats where you, not a bomb first pick, but you'd pick her and be happy. So why not? All right.
Is that your honorable mention?
That's my honorable mention. It's my old school honorable mention. I am a fan. Nighthawk is another one, not on the list, spoiler, but that I was thinking about honorable mention, but I wanted to go super old school with the honorable mention, just see if I can catch you. So, all right. Coming in at number eight, top eight EDH vampires. Enowon the Ruin Sage. 2/3 for a 4/3 legendary vampire shaman. At the beginning of your upkeep, each player sacrifices a non-vampire creature.
Yeah, I picked this card. I mean, it did come out with Edgar Markov in 2017, and it's just a giant threat. At the beginning of your upkeep, each player having to sacrifice a non-vampire creature, and pretty much the way I play my Edgar Markov deck is it's vampire tribal. So all of my creatures are vampires pretty much. So it really puts pressure on the table and makes you a big target. That's for sure.
Yeah. And this is like, he's basically an abyss. I'm not sure if that's another old school card. And this was a real popular strategy in the old school days of Magic. There's an enchantment called the Abyss. Every turn, each player has to sacrifice a non-artifact creature, but it targets. So you would A, play artifact creatures like Juggernauts, or B, you know, you could have things like White Knights, but you can't target it because it's got protection. But this was the kind of thing, it's like you wanted to build these kind of attrition strategies where you had control and you could protect it. You know, you just play like artifact creatures, who cares? I'll beat you down with Juggernauts and Tsuchis and win the game that way. Meanwhile, every turn you're losing creatures over and over. Now, with EDH, I can't even imagine. The only problem, the only thing I was thinking is, I know some EDH strategies, they go wide, right? It's like if your opponent has a bunch of tokens, you may be like, okay, well, this isn't quite having the punch I want.
Yeah, that's very true. And that's exactly how I run my Eckard deck, is very wide with a token theme. Mm-hmm. But I also, like in my play group, a lot of people play with like indestructible creatures and a lot of like Voltron builds. Ooh. So this like really, really messes those up.
That's I love that. You think you're so safe with your indestructibility?
Yeah.
Sack it.
You have to sacrifice it. Yeah. Yeah. I actually, in my play group, I don't play against a lot of players that do go wide. So this is perfect for those Voltron builds.
That's awesome.
Like Rithik, you know, they just have one creature out and
it's then dead. They got none. That's perfect. I love it. Coming in at number seven, Sanctum Seeker. 2/2 other for a 3/4 vampire knight. Whenever a vampire you control attacks, each opponent loses one life and you gain one life. Oh my gosh, go wide and just suck them dry.
Exactly. Yeah, this card came from Ixalan, and it is also kind of one of my favorite cards back then to draft, because you can really do a whole theme around this. Mm-hmm. So when you're going wide and you have a vampire simply just attack, then yeah, you're getting massive value, especially if you have other cards in there that have a life gain effect, which we'll go more into very soon.
Shortly. I love effects like this too, because it's one of those things where you're in a game and in group games, and part of the things with EDH, at least my lone game of experience, that you see is people marshal their resources. And the first few turns seem to be all about two things. One, negotiating with your fellow players.
Yes.
And two, marshaling your defenses, preparing for the mid to late game. And one of the things you can see happen with effects like Sanctum Seeker is, oh, great, you have all these blockers, or you have all these walls, or it's something like Humility where, you know, well, Humility would remove creature type. But, you know, you feel safe. But if I swing at you with six of these, you're taking six. And it's getting through. There's no blocking. There's nothing. And I'm gaining six, but it's a way to get through defenses. And I love that aspect of it, because it's like just when you felt, because keep in mind, you have a ton of vampires. Oh, no. What am I going to do? I can't get through. Then you play the Sanctum Seeker. The effect is live. You attack with all the other pyres. So I love it. One of the other things about Sanctum Seeker that I think is really interesting, and you get that EDH feel, right? Like as a non-EDH player, I read these cards. And I go, wait a minute. This is EDH-y. Is it's each opponent.
That's right. So whenever a vampire you control attacks, it's actually hitting everyone at the table. So
that's a great point. Like,
yeah, all three of your opponents. So it's super powerful.
So and just to be clear, what that means is when I swing on Trace, everybody loses one life and I'm gaining three life with my vampire.
Exactly.
That's crazy. I read the card just now for the top eight. I didn't even see that. So that's huge. That's pretty, pretty nuts. And you can see kind of perfect for EDH. Number six on our list, Nighthawk Scavenger. A new vampire has entered the arena. Two black, one other for a vampire rogue with 1+ star power and 3 toughness. It's got flying, death touch, lifelink. Nighthawk Scavenger's power is equal to 1+ the number of card types among cards in your opponent's graveyards. So it doesn't count your graveyard, count your opponent's graveyard. And once again, we see that plural S, opponents.
Opponents. So probably at least 3 opponents at that point. So this is very, very powerful. I still need to add this physically to my deck because these keywords are just insane. Flying, death touch, and lifelink. Mm-hmm. You know, with Ekker Markov, you can have kind of a sub theme of lifelink going on because there's a lot of life gain triggers that are happening. This card is seeing a lot of play right now, actually, in Standard because of the Rogue deck that's out there. Have you seen that?
I have seen that. I have seen that.
I hate that deck. But it's also super, super good for Commander. So
some of these creatures, maybe all these creatures, that's why they're on this list. Like, I feel like you play a card like this and all of a sudden everyone, like, you got a target on your back. Like, everyone's just like, wait a second, Trace, what's going on? We're going to have to take care of this or take care of you or both, right?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
And as I said, it's every opponent's graveyard. So you could see, it's such a shame it's not 1+ star, 1+ star. I guess the creature would be so good at 3 mana if it did that, because 3 toughness, you can find a way to deal with 3 toughness, but you could see the power on the scavenger getting out of hand very, very quickly. The joke I like to tell is this is what happens when a vampire bites a Lurgoyf. You know, this is what you get. You get a Nighthawk Scavenger, because it's that graveyard Lurgoyf, Tarmogoyf. What was the original one? The graveyard. I can't remember. It's the black one. Chronotog. Well, it'll come to me at some point. All right, coming in at number 5, another newish comer. I actually drafted this card a few times, really, really powerful, and yet never worked out for me. Veto, Thorn of the Dusk Rose, 1+, 2 other for a 1/3 legendary vampire cleric. Whenever you gain life, target opponent loses that much life. And so if all these cards we're already talking about are in the same deck together, you can see how this is starting a terrible cycle here.
Exactly.
And for 2 black, 3 other, creatures you control gain lifelink until end of turn. So Vito just feeds himself. He's not waiting for that lifelinker. He'll give you lifelink and you go to town.
Yeah. I mean, he'll give all of your wide vampire tokens lifelink. And when you have that in combination with like the Sanctum Seeker that we just talked about, you're like doubling your effect.
Right, because you gain the I bite you with the Sanctum Seeker, I gain life, then Vito bites you again, right? And then things have lifelink, and that's another bite. Vito, like, you know, they say, you know, you don't get more than one bite at the apple. Vito's taking bite after bite after bite at the apple. So
exactly.
it's super
powerful. I personally just added this to my deck. I added a lot more of the life gain triggers to my vampire deck because of Vito. And I actually really like drafting Vito as well in limited.
He was great.
If you can get the right pieces,
he's a bomb.
Really works.
I think he was an absolute bomb. My failing with him in a draft deck was not Vito's fault. That was all on this guy right here. He's very, very good I really struggled with black in M21. It was so bad. But yes, he is insane.
So yeah, I'm more of like splashed Vito. I mean, because there wasn't like a lot of life gain type of creatures. So
that's true.
Just that ability to pay 5 and give all your creatures lifelink and getting that trigger off of him was really, really good and really valuable. I think
it was your end game. You could win right
there.
It's
your end game. Right? Yeah.
If you have enough creatures on the board, you could do it. So there you have it. Those are our bottom 4 and our top 8 EDH vampires. We had Anawan the Ruined Sage, Sanctum Seeker, Nighthawk Scavenger, and Vito, Thorn of the Dusk. Hit pause real quick and tell us what else you think. What are the top 4? 4, 3, 2, 1, top 8 EDH vampires. No cheating. You got to hit pause. You got to really, really kind of noodle it around. I think you can probably guess number 1 at this point, but there's 3 other slots you got to fill. In the meantime, I do want to ask Tracy, have you put that new 3-2 vampire cleric from Zendikar Rising in your deck? The one that's like same ability as Vito. It's like it's 1 black, 2 other for 3-2. Every time you gain life, your opponent it deals 1 damage to your opponent.
Marauding
cleric or something like that.
I haven't, but I know which one you're talking about.
Yeah, I don't know if it does each opponent. It must. I think in Magic these days they do. It's key to the cleric deck in Zendikar Rising, and I'm pretty sure it's a vampire. So check that out.
Okay, I'm gonna have to check that out.
Look at that. I'm building EDH decks now.
I know. All
right, on to our top 4 here. Coming in at number 4, a very, very polite, creature, a cordial vampire. 2 black for a 1/1 vampire. Whenever cordial vampire or another creature dies, put a +1/+1 counter on each vampire you control. Jesus, yeah. That seems like a very, very each vampire?
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. So not only are you going wide, you're also going tall at the same time. It's really, really good. Just it doesn't seem that powerful, but whenever you have all of your vampire tokens out and you don't mind them dying, it's okay, you know. Well, everything's just going to grow and get bigger. It's fine. Attack me.
this causes those awkward combat exchanges, right?
Exactly.
Where it's like, wait a minute. Do I really want to block here? I'm going to kill. And then, you know, because you don't have to swing with all your creatures. You swing with the ones you're ready to die, and you keep the ones back that you want to grow. And Cordial Vampire, he triggers on himself. So it's like one of those things where it's like, you get through for 1 every time because nobody wants to block this guy because you got 4 other vampires and he's just going to grow them. You know, that's not going to get you anywhere in EDH. But when you have effects that start to make the combat math screwy, and sometimes it's because the creatures are going to get larger right away, but sometimes it's because, wait a minute, if I kill these creatures, if I block, I'm going to kill that creature. And then everything else is going to get bigger. That's not bueno. I don't want to live that life. And so that's where cards like Cordial Vampire start to get real tricky.
Yeah, especially this in combination with Blood Artist. Blood Artist is super, super awesome. And it almost made the list, but like it probably should be on the list. It's so good. Blood Artist, whenever Blood Artist or another creature dies, target player loses a life, you gain a life. So it's just giving you like more triggers for like the whole synergy of the deck, really. Yeah,
it's veto so or anything else, it just keeps going and going.
Yeah.
Like, this deck really feels like it's just like, these decks are so tricky to play with, like I said, where you're just waiting for that first domino to fall over. Mm-hmm. And everyone's just thinking to themselves, if I block here, if I do this, am I knocking over that first domino? Where does it all end? So, which are great. I think that's wonderful. Number three on our list, Captivating Vampire. 2/1 for a 2/2 vampire. Other vampire creatures you control get +1/+1. So we have a Vampire Lord. Tap 5 untapped vampires you control. Gain control of target creature. It becomes a vampire in addition to its other types. Now, look, you got to have 5 untapped vampires. So 4 others. You have Captivating Vampire and 4 others. But you get that creature forever. This is not an end of turn effect. This is like that mine. You're here now.
Yes. Yes, exactly. Stealing a creature. And it's actually really not hard to do because Ekker Markov is making tons of tokens, which we'll get into that. Mm-hmm. But it's kind of similar to the Legion's Lieutenant. So your other vampires you control get +1/+1, but it just has that extra effect on it, onto it. So it's giving you more versatility in the card.
Well, and keep in mind, this is you don't need to tap the Captivating Vampire. So as you steal more, those creatures turn into vampires. So now it becomes easier to activate the Captivating Vampire twice.
That's
like
true.
Again, it's that snowball effect, right? Once it starts with one and then it keeps growing, and the ability, I mean, obviously, look, there should be a payoff if you have an effect that requires 10 vampires and you have 10 vampires. I absolutely believe there should be a payoff, but there is a way, right? The Captivating Vampire keeps growing the horde and getting more and more powerful, more and more captivating maybe, and stealing and stealing and stealing. So again, you can see how this gets very out of hand.
Similar to the effect that Olivia is doing, I choose this card simply because I went with Vampire Tribal. And so I'm just like, yeah. But Olivia is also good because you can steal creatures. So.
You can steal, but I mean, the cost here is so much easier. It's not 5 mana. You know, you have multiple vampires on the board. If you have 4.
It's faster. To me, in my opinion.
It totally is. I mean, there's no doubt, right? If you somehow have 4 vampires out, you drop the Captivating Vampire, you immediately get this effect, right? Because it's a colon effect, so you don't need to actually tap. There's no summoning sickness involved. You have 4 other vampires. You drop the Captivating Vampire. You take the best creature on the board. It's yours, and it's a vampire now. Even if you lose the Captivating Vampire at that point, granted he's a 2/2. You've stolen that creature for the rest of the game. So
exactly.
Why not?
You can go with steal it. Their commander. Steal your opponent's commander, which is really rude.
Have you done that, Trace?
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
Many times.
Oh my gosh. So
it's the worst.
Sad face. So number 2 on our list, we've got another Lord. Stromkirk Captain. 1 red, 1 black, 1 other for a 2/2 first striking vampire soldier. Other vampires you control get +1/+1 and have first strike.
Yes. So again, very similar to how the Legion's Lieutenant reads. It's just, it has first strike instead. So why not? This is better.
Yeah. No, totally.
It's pumping everything and they have first strike. It's super cool.
Similar to what I said with the Cordial Vampire, where all of a sudden all that combat math gets a little fuzzy. It gets a little funky. Like, what are you going to do? You know, first strike, you're attacking. If something gets sacked or dies, now everything has +1/+1 before blocks and first strike damage resolves. And they don't, you know, there's so many ways that first strike, I love it. It's like one of my favorite kind of keyword abilities. It makes things so funky.
It makes it complicated.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's why I play aggro. Don't have to worry about blocking. Just attack. Just keep attacking. Don't have to worry about it. All right. Coming in at number 1 on our list of top 8 EDH vampires. You've heard his name plenty during this top 8. It should come as no surprise at all. Number 1 on our list, the one, the only, Ekker Markov. He is 1 black, 1 white, 1 red, 3 other for a legendary vampire knight. 4/4 has eminence. Whenever you cast another vampire spell, if Ekker Markov is in the command zone or on the battlefield, so you just keep him chilling.
Yeah.
Create a 1/1 black vampire creature token. He's got first strike and haste. So when he's ready to come out and play, right away.
Yep.
Whenever Edgar Markov attacks, put a +1/+1 counter on each vampire you control. So he's just chilling, growing the horde, and then boom, he comes down and everything gets a +1/+1.
And you're dead.
Wow. Yeah,
that's usually how that works. You kind of wait for that moment to bring him out, to pump everything and go in for the kill. Yeah.
Jeez.
Super powerful. Now, this list, I just wanted to point out, this list is not necessarily like the top eight vampires of all time or the top eight EDH vampires. This is like the top eight
tribal
vampires for Edgar Markov, because this is one of my favorite decks. And I love this effect. I mean, you're just constantly putting vampires on the battlefield. It's really, really difficult to deal with. And it's a very aggro deck. So if you're looking for an aggro deck that is just super fun, gets crazy very fast, I would definitely try out Edgar Markov, who is Soren's grandfather, by the way. Did you know that?
Oh, I thought it was the other way around. Because Soren's really old, but Edgar is
Okay. Hey, look. Do we need to look up the lore? I'm not too familiar, but I thought that Edgar was Soren's grandfather.
I totally believe you.
It was the other way around?
I just assume that. I have nothing to base that on. I just know Soren's like super duper old. Like, I think he's the second oldest. Like, Nicol Bolas is the oldest planeswalker. I guess maybe Ugin and Nicol Bolas are tied for oldest. And then I know Soren's like number two because he's been around for a really long time.
Okay, so Edgar Markov is the founder of the Markov bloodline and the very first vampire of Innistrad.
Oh, so he
thousands
does predate.
Thousands of years ago. Yeah. So there you go. So thousands of years ago, he was an aging human alchemist experimenting with ways to achieve agelessness for himself and his only grandson, Soren.
And he got there. There you go. I never really doubted you.
Yes, it's true.
There you go.
I do like Soren, though. I do run with Soren in my deck. I mean, yeah.
I think we all kind of love Soren.
Yeah, how can you not?
I like Soren. He's kind of punk. I like. I'm with Soren. I like Soren. I'm not a big vampire person. It's okay. I don't like the taste of blood. I don't like to taste that irony flavor.
Ew. Oh.
Trace, okay, if you're gonna be a vampire, if you're gonna be a vampire, you got to get used to the taste of blood. You got to think about those kinds of things. If you're a vampire, let me ask something, because you know, all the stuff inside is different. Like, if you're a vampire and you blow your nose, is it like blood?
Yes. You cry tears of blood. Can vampires even cry, though?
I'm sure they can. Look at Soren. I'm sure that Soren has had plenty of emo moments. I hope he can cry. We all need a good cry sometimes. Just because you're undead doesn't mean you don't need a good cry.
Pretty sure vampires cry blood. So they would snot blood too, I would imagine.
That's very uncomfortable. I don't know how we got here. It's my fault. It's my fault. I did it. It's my fault. I'm sorry, everyone. It's my fault.
Oh my God.
There you go. Our top eight tribal, vampire tribal EDH cards, ending with the original vampire, Edgar Markov. And yeah, he's pretty wonderful because the whole board develops, right? You have Edgar chilling in the command zone. You're casting vampire, and you're getting so much extra value with every vampire you cast. And then when it's time to come in for the kill, here comes Grandpa. Yep. So I love it. It makes total sense to me.
Awesome.
Well, Trace, thank you so much.
Okay, so you're gonna play more Commander now, right? You're gonna
I'm undefeated right now. I'm undefeated. And I feel like if I play with Riley again, because I just remember this so vividly. He was sitting to my left and I just got this feeling that he was about to go off and I just slaughtered him. Like, and he was like, "What are you doing? Why are you targeting me?" And I was like, "I think you're the one." Like, he had like some kind of combo thing. I was like, "No, I'm so fine."
Game. Like, you do need to know or pick a target very wisely. I felt really bad before they go off.
I felt really bad though, because my intuition was correct, but then he showed me his hand and he was nowhere near. I was like, he's getting close. He's getting close. And because he had so much mana, and I knew what his deck was supposed to do.
Just vote Riley out.
Yep, that's what I did. I feel no regret.
Did you do that today in Among Us as well?
Oh my gosh, I was struggling in that game. I had no idea what I was doing.
I was watching y'all play, and you were like, I think you were the imposter, and you were like, what's a vent? How do I vent?
I actually.
That is a huge part of being imposter, but you'll learn. Was that your very first time playing?
I played once before. We have a Channel Fireball cocktail hour. And so just like with three other people online, I played just real softball. But I played like one round and then I had to go. So that was my first real time playing. And those guys, I was up there. I was like, wait, how do I get to the map again? And then my first time imposter, I couldn't figure out how to kill anyone. I'm running around trying to kill people because you're supposed to hit E, and somehow my keyboard, I got to look at this. My keyboard was all jacked up.
You could just click kill or sabotage.
That's what I started doing. I had to kind of like double Q because I was moving with my mouse, and then I have a touch screen on my laptop. So I'm just like hitting. I'm like literally like hitting the kill button, trying to kill people while they're next to me. So yeah, it's a lot of fun, but I definitely felt like a fish out of water, and I felt bad because every time I was the imposter, whoever was with me had to like do 90% of the killing. I had one good round where I accidentally killed someone. I killed them on purpose, but I accidentally self-reported.
And everyone, I did that.
And everyone was just
beginning,
like,
I did that.
My ineptness shielded me because everyone was like, oh, there's no way Masha did that. I'm like, yeah, I just found the body. I didn't know. Okay, so what's going on here? And we were down to it. And then we ended up voting the other person off. And then I just had to follow Jeff and then kill him right away because it was just me and two others. And I guess when it's down to one and one, you just win.
Yeah. Oh my God. What an amazing way to win, though.
It was great. It was very, very.
That's impressive.
Very satisfying. But I do encourage you guys, check out Talia playing a lot of Among Us, from what I understand. Twitch.tv/TaliaVest. It's Talia with two A's. 2 p.m. Central, Monday through Friday for Magic. And some Among Us, it looks like. Before we went live, you mentioned that you have a standard tournament coming up. Are you going to be streaming that?
Yes, I will be streaming. It's on Monday. So it's with LFM, and it's called Looking for More. And we're going to be going up against some really, really amazing players. I'm going up against Amy, Amazonian, Danny, and I'm not super competitive. I'm definitely more of a casual player. So it's going to be very interesting, but I'm going to try to bring my best and do my best. So we will see.
I'm sure you're going to bring your best. I look forward to it. Do you know what you're going to play?
I really want to play Selesnya Adventures.
Oh,
I know.
Okay. I guess that makes sense.
But I like really want to play with the Innkeeper. So I'm going to play test that a little bit more today and figure it out. But
wow, my old tried and true.
It's all rogues and Rakdos, and I don't really like either of those. So I'm trying to look for something different.
When in doubt, play mono red. That's what I always do.
That's true. I did get to mythic 3 times with mono red. So
holy crap.
Mono red is like my go-to. If I'm trying to like just speed through and get mythic, mono red always works.
If you are worried about rogues, you have Ox of Agonis and the Phoenix to just escape out. Like, hey, thank you. So
yep.
Well, good luck in that tournament. Thank you so much for hanging. This was awesome. We'll have to do it again sometime. What we should do is we can just work through a bunch of EDH tribes, but then you have to build different tribal decks. You can't stick with vampires.
I have a lot of tribal decks.
Oh, do you?
I have a lot. I built like 32 decks right now.
I feel like you've been setting me up this whole time. You got me from vampires into this tribal vampire EDH thing. And then I was like, we should do other tribes. But then you have to try it out. You're like, oh, don't worry. I've got 32.
Yes. Wow. I could talk about that all day.
Awesome. Well, thanks again, Trace. Have a wonderful weekend. Good luck on Monday. And yeah, for everyone else, thank you for hanging out with us. If you're listening to the podcast, hit subscribe. Check out the video on YouTube on channelfireball.com. I'll be back next week with a different guest. I think I have Josh Utter Layton. I don't know if you know Raptor. He's an old Hall of Famer. Doesn't play Magic anymore. He plays a ton of Runeterra these days, but he is... Okay. An amazing, he came up in the Channel Fireball Game Center way back in the day. I was there when he was like grinding PTQs, and then he ended up being an exceptional Magic player. He's in the Magic Hall of Fame, won Pro Tours, top 8 Pro Tour. So he's unbelievable. And an old friend. So he's joining me next week for next week's Magic TV. Until then, everybody, thanks for hanging, and be wonderful to yourself and be wonderful to each other. Take care, everyone.